small introduction about our activities, like what we are doing with Unite Maps. But anyway, in our projects, we are basically mapping, editing topographic features. So we are editing roads, waterways, residential areas, and villages. So we are putting the place information. If you go to the project and you click on contribute, you can see the instructions. So who is already using ID Editor can have like an overview of the tags we are using mainly. We have, for example, the highways, primary, secondary, tertiary, which are like, let's say, uncommon to map. We have many unclassified residential and tracks and paths. Then for the we are also putting the surface characteristics of the roads, so we are putting paved or unpaved information just to say if there is a asphalt or just ground on the road. And most of the times you will have to choose unpaved as a surface characteristic. Then we are mapping also waterways, and most of the times they are rivers and streams, sometimes also canals and drains. And we are also putting the intermittency information. So we are putting if the stream is intermittent, so it is not there, it is not there during the year, but sometimes you can see like some intermittent waterways in such a way that they are maybe disappearing in dry season and then appearing in wet season. And sometimes you can also add this seasonal equal to yes tag, and you can also put the seasonal equal to wet season to just to say that the water course is present in the water season, in the rainy season. Then we have residential areas. They are mainly polygons that are mapped all around the city. And these are pretty easy to map. You have to enclose the cities within the land use residential polygon. And then places. In Africa, most of the times we are mapping places with nodes. So we are putting nodes within the residential areas polygons. And we can have different tags on these for the places. So we have locality, if in case of places with no population, but they are carrying the name of the locality. So most of the times this place equal to locality is used with villages that are no more there, but they still carry name information. So we put them as a place equal to locality in order not to waste the place information. Then we have a place equal to isolated dwelling. These places are they are the smallest kind of settlements. So generally speaking, they have like one or two households. So one or two families are living in these places. And also it is not the number of the huts you can count. Because many times in Africa, one family is using many huts, not only one, and this is because they are using them also to carry goods, for example, or to host animals and so on. So yes, so here there are some pictures of these small settlements. And then we have hamlets, which are a little bit bigger settlements with less than 200 inhabitants and between 2 and 20 households. And usually these settlements don't have services like schools and dispensaries. Then we have villages, which are settlements with these services, so schools, dispensaries, or place of worships, and so on. But they have between 200 and 10,000 inhabitants and more than 20 households. And then we have towns, which are very rare to map, but yes, they are larger cities, big settlements, and they are small cities with more than 10,000 inhabitants. So I guess for the ones that don't know, OpenStreetMap is quite difficult to understand the tags. Indeed, I will like do an introduction of our project and then also a little bit of OpenStreetMap. Who already knows to map on ID Editor can go on. So just click on one task. This is an area that you can keep for yourself to map. Then you select here ID Editor and you start to map the tasks. And we will be mapping together anyway in a little while. While for the others, another option you can do, if you want to learn JOSM, I can share, or Rachele maybe can share the link to download JOSM which is a Java application. And we find it very useful to map topographic features on OpenStreetMap because, you know, ID Editor is quite clunky on these things, and it is easier to trace ways and adjust polygons, relations, and so on. So yes, actually we love JOSM, we use it a lot. So anyway, we will be using that one, but if you have experience with ID Editor and you can do on your own, please go ahead, use the editor you want. Okay, so I will do a small introduction of Unite Maps. So what is all about? Unite Maps is an initiative we are carrying on. We are basically a group of GIS consultants at the UN Global Service Center, which is the logistic base of the United Nations. And the logistic base is in Brindisi in Italy. And this project has been started by the logistic base and also by the geospatial information section in New York from the headquarters and by three peacekeeping missions, which are UNSOS in Somalia, MONUSCO in Democratic Republic of the Congo and MINUSCA in Central African Republic. Unite Maps project is basically carry on an activity the UN was doing already before, so the production of topographic maps for the UN peacekeeping missions. But we are trying to change a little bit the paradigm, and we are trying to release all the data, the geospatial data we are creating in OpenStreetMap. What is OpenStreetMap? OpenStreetMap is like a open database. Is usually they call it the Wikipedia of maps. So basically, it is a database in which every user everywhere in the world can add, modify, or delete geospatial data into this database. And the point is that everyone can download freely the data from OpenStreetMap, so that they can use the data to create geospatial applications or websites or do whatever application they want with the data that is in the database. So basically, if we are editing OpenStreetMap, not only the UN peacekeeping mission will use our data to conduct their peacekeeping operation and security operation, also logistic and navigation activities, but also other people like local communities or other companies working maybe with those countries or other NGOs can use the data of OpenStreetMap that actually we are all editing together. So Unite Maps is providing a different series of services to the peacekeeping missions. We have the street map, which is basically a global base map with the data we are tracing, providing contextual information to the missions. Then we have image maps, which are collections of UN-managed satellite imageries. And then we are also providing web services to visualize operational activities for the carried out by the UN missions. And then we are working also towards having a global three-dimensional solution to visualize the data, geocoding applications to find addresses and points of interest, and also routing services to navigate the ways we are tracing on the database. Among the cartographic products, we have basically the topographic maps, which are 50k scale maps with all the topographic features, so physical and human features, and the 100k scale maps, which are basically a composition of 450k. These maps are basically carry on all the information I told you before, so waterways, highways, land cover, and land use, and also some point of interest. And the very same missions that are supporting the project are asking for these areas of interest. So basically they are asking us to map these 50k areas of their interest, and then we can provide the data of the areas they want. Then we have the city maps, which are like precision maps at 10k scale. And basically they are reproducing building footprints, streets, and point of interest. And also the missions are able to, they can use the MOD application we are producing in order to customize these maps. And they can, for example, obtain city maps that are focusing on some particular feature, like, for example, places of worships or shops and so on. So they can customize the maps they are receiving. And then focus maps, which are maps at 2,500. And these maps are reproducing in a very detail the operational basis, the UN camps. So they are very detailed maps for the UN camps. But our main objective is to produce the topographic maps. So we are editing this data together, both with internal facility of mappers. So we have, 17 GIS consultants. They are mapping on OpenStreetMap, adding this data. And then we are also trying to engage with the crowdsourcing. We are trying to engage a community of mappers, and we call this network UN Mappers, which are basically is a community composed by UN personnel on the field. So basically we are engaging with GIS staff, police and military on the field, but also with academia, high schools and universities, other NGOs, and also local communities and remote volunteers. So basically we are trying to do these collaborative activities to crowdsource the data all together, maybe contacting also already existing mapping associations. We have also different products for the crowdsourcing. We have the leaderboard, which is displaying at any time all the users, sort of leaderboard, a gamification of the editing we are doing with the users and their contributions. So there are all the statistics, the number of edits they are committing, the kilometers of waterways, highways, land cover, and use they are mapping. In that case, the squared kilometers. So this is a pretty nice thing that the users can see the leaderboard of different countries, and maybe they can reach the top of the country they are interested to map. We are mapping for five missions. So we are supporting UNSOS, MONUSCO, and MINUSCA, and also MINUSMA in Mali, and UNISFA in ABA, and today we will be mapping in ABA. And UNISFA is the mission working between Sudan and South Sudan. ABA is an independent region, between Sudan and South Sudan. So you may be wondering, what is OpenStreetMap? So I can go and show you the website of OpenStreetMap. So this is OpenStreetMap. It is not really a map. It's a database because it's a collection of data. And then third party application, everyone can use the data to create maps or applications. So basically, you can use the data for whatever application you want. If you have GIS experience, you can for example, use the data to do 3D visualizations, or maybe use the data to compute statistics or to conduct a scientific research. There are many, many purposes. So OpenStreetMap is a huge map. You can see our, I mean, the areas in which we are editing, because you can see from the land cover, I mean, we are mapping topographic features, so from the land cover you can easily see where we are working on. So for example, here I am in Somalia. You can see all the farmlands we were mapping, the scrub, all the roads. Basically, we are mapping everything but buildings. I mean, we are not very interested in mapping buildings for now, I mean, for the 50K scale maps. But yes, these maps are very detailed. So yes, maybe we can start with the editing. I don't know if I have, on the other end, maybe to introduce OpenStreetMap, like the geometries, and I don't know, Rachele, what do you think?
Maybe a quick review of the three types of features.
Okay. So let me go on OneDrive. Okay, so basically we have OpenStreetMap is, I don't know if you even have like GIS experience, but basically we have the OpenStreetMap data model is quite different from the traditional GIS data formats that we are using. So most of the times traditional GIS have a proprietary data format and basically the shape file, while OpenStreetMap has a free and open source format, the XML, which have like different derivatives, like the OpenStreetMap file and the OpenStreetMap history, OpenStreetMap change, and so on. So basically, the XML is like a text document, and every user is modifying blocks of this text document. I mean, you can imagine that like the all the data of the world in this huge text document, and everyone is adding, modifying, or deleting pieces of document from the very same document or at the same time everywhere in the world. So traditional GIS is also usually divided in thematic layers. So we have like one layer with all the polygons, meaning that layer are the lakes. Then maybe we have all the lines, and these layers are the rivers. Then we have points to target wells, and so on. This is like an example of a water system. While in OpenStreetMap, the concept is quite different because we have a tagging system. This tagging system basically is composed by many tags that we are applying to the features, to the geometries. And basically, as everyone is editing OpenStreetMap, also the tags are decided by the community. So it is very important that like everyone is editing the very same like resource, and then everyone has his, can specify the tags to be used, and there are many discussions about the tags to be used. There is somewhat a democracy in which the most used tags are also the ones that the community decided. So, but I will go in the details in a little while. Traditional GIS is edited by single users, while in OpenStreetMap multiple users are editing the map at the same time in different parts of the world. So we have OpenStreetMap objects. Between the OpenStreetMap objects, we have basically geometric primitives like node which is basically a pair of coordinates. So these are simply points. Then we have ways, which are collection of nodes. Basically, they are like redirecting to the different nodes in the map. So these ones can be either open or closed. An open way is a line, while a closed way is a polygon. And then we have relations, which are like a different type of collection, like a different type of OpenStreetMap objects, and basically they are collection of different objects, and they are like a feature that is basically mapped by advanced users. And then, okay, the attribution. So once we are tracing the geometry, we have to put within this geometry the information. So we have tags, which are composed by a key and value strings. The key is a category, so we are basically saying that maybe we are tracing like a rectangle, let's say, and we want to say this is a building. So we have the key, which is building, and then with the value, which is the second part of the tag, we can specify the category. So basically we can say the building is can be a yes, just to say that is a general building and I don't know the what is the purpose of that building, or maybe I can put a building equal to house if I know that this is a building which people are living, or maybe I can be even more specific and there are also many other tags apartments and so on. And these tags are basically specified by the community. So the community are voting different tags, and we have this beautiful wiki OpenStreetMap, which is our main point of reference, in which you can see all the tags are here. So you can see every tag is explained, and every tag basically has its own wiki page. So let's say I would like to map, I don't know how to map bars, for example. I can go to amenity bar, I check the wiki page of bars, and so there is a full description. There are also some points like bars are different from pubs. So there are also differences before other tags. And also there are tags that are useful to use in combinations. So I can stack different tags, one above the other to say, basically to add more specific information about an object. And also there are some photos sometimes. So these tags are basically decided by the community, and the community is, whenever someone would like to propose another tag, you can basically enter in contact with the OpenStreetMap community through the mailing list, start a proposal process, discussing many, many weeks and months and maybe years to propose a tag. And this is is both nice and bad, because you see that all the tags anyway they are discussed by experts, while in other cases maybe can be frustrating to discuss every time with the community and never reach a solution. But yes, this is it. But by the way, most of the tags are already on OpenStreetMap. I mean, you can basically map everything, and I mean the resolution of the classification of the data is incredible. You can map very strange things like the number of steps of stairs and other particular features. Okay, so whenever we finish to map, we are basically collecting all the data that we traced into chain sets. And what the editor is doing is to send this chain set to the OpenStreetMap database and modify the database. Basically, the user doesn't have to really worry about the chain set because it's something automatically compiled by the editor. The user is only asked to add one comment called the chain set comment. The chain set comment is basically a comment that is traveling together with the chain set and allows like other people to check what you did. And they are very important to discuss like what, I mean, the mapping you did. So basically, most of the times, basically always you have to say what you mapped in few words. And also sometimes you can put hashtags in order to to be identified in mapping campaigns. So basically, if someone would like to compute the statistics of all the UM mappers, and so me, you have to add the hashtag UM mappers into your comment. This is not a problem because using the tasking manager, the editor already knows that he has to put some hashtags that we decided in advance. So basically, you don't have to do anything else to that. Maybe adding some details on what you mapped. And these chain sets have like the same usage in Wikipedia. Like also in Wikipedia, when you are writing or modifying an article, you are requested to put a chain set and like to describe what you did. And this is also useful to do rollbacks. In this way, you can basically go back to the previous situation of the database and you can delete some chain sets that maybe are committed by newbies, so they have bad data. Or maybe some vandalism, so you can recover the situation from vandalism and other bad data solutions. Okay, the next things are not very interesting, like the OpenStreetMap architecture. So I guess we can jump into the editor. So if you don't have any editor, you can maybe start with, I don't know if it is, usually for beginners, ID editor is easier to, just also to understand all the concepts. But yes, I don't know, maybe I can go with ID. ID editor is basically a browser editor, so it is available to any browser. While JOSM is an application written in Java, and as you can imagine, it has more functionalities like also plugins and so on. So let me know what editor do you want to use, and in the meantime, do you have any question about OpenStreetMap or Unite Maps? No questions. Yes, Erika or Maria?
I was wondering a little bit more about, I'm sorry I was a few minutes late, but I wondered if you might describe UN mappers a little bit more, because I think I understand what you all want to do with Unite Maps, and I'm wondering who are the UN mappers who you call on.
Okay. So the UN mappers are basically the community, the crowdsourcing community of the that are like mapping within the Unite Maps project. So let me jump into the wiki. Let me search for it. So I will go to Unite Maps. No, okay, I can go here. So basically, UN Mappers is this network of communities. Basically, we are trying to reach everyone that is interested to collaborate with us. Yes, so we did already some events in the past, especially, there are some big events like one day we mapped with an high school in Northern Italy. And I maybe I can share some. Let me search OICT. So one time we mapped like with an high school. Basically, we did like one week of training with them, and we were training them how to map barriers on in Somalia. And so these students learned how to map on OpenStreetMap map, and they were editing like an area of 700 km², basically adding barriers. So they are like a particular feature in Somalia, because nomadic people are using those barriers to like as meadows for the animals. So basically, if you know where these barriers are, you basically can also know like the movements like the people are doing to go from one part to the other. So you can see here all the geometries that have been added. We have like more than 4,000 geometries in like 2 weeks, I guess. So this is like one sort of event we were doing with schools. So basically these students for their activity, I mean, they both learned how to use OpenStreetMap. That maybe can be like a good skill set for them in the future. Maybe if they want to go on with geography studies. But for their mapping activity, they've been part of the UN Mappers. So basically, we engaged with them, and they helped us and the Unite Maps initiative to retrieve geospatial data for the UN peacekeeping missions. This is like an example of an activity we did. We have also like an activity with the OpenStreetMap Mali community. So we engaged with them. They were editing from Bamako, and so basically, yes, the UN Mappers is like the umbrella of communities that are mapping with us. Yes, I don't know if I gave more or less the idea. We were also running some interesting community activities, like the logo contest. And now we are like finalizing the logo, and it will be out very, very soon. And also, yes, stay in touch with all the OpenStreetMap activities and organization, like through the social media. And also you can follow us there in order to see all the other events we are doing. So basically, yes, the UN Mappers, it's us, so the mappers within the Global Service Center in Brindisi, but also all the remote volunteers that would like to join our efforts. We have also a mailing list, so you can send us an email if you want to be inserted, and we are telling our events.
Thank you.
Okay, so for the editor, you would like to go, would you like to see Jocelyn, or maybe should I go with ID?
I have worked with ID before, so I would actually be interested in seeing how Jocelyn works.
Okay, so to install JOSM, you have to go to the link that Rachele put in the chat. This is the page of JOSM. If you have Windows, you just have to install the JOSM tested jar file. Actually, jar is like a virtual machine, so basically it works every time. It takes only to have like the Java version. I guess it is Java 8 plus. So if you have Java installed in your computer, it basically runs, it basically run well. So just download the file, double click on it, and you can open JOSM. So I had it already open here, so maybe I can delete all these things. Go away. So this is the basically the interface of JOSM. I don't know if you already installed it or not. But yes, if you want to use the, both the Hot Tasking Manager and JOSM together, you have to do some little steps in the settings, like modifying the settings in order to be able to use the Tasking Manager in an efficient way. So once you install the JOSM, you can go on Edit, Preferences. And here you can find many options that you can set for the JOSM. Basically, you can access with your OpenStreetMap account. So there is this with this option with two screens, and you can ask for an access token. You have just to put your username and password of OpenStreetMap, and then you will be like logged in every time when using JOSM. So yes, this is like a mandatory step in order not to log in every time you are editing. And then another important option is to use the is to set the remote control, which is this icon with the receiver. So you can click on this icon with the receiver, and you have to click on enable remote control. This remote control basically allows JOSM to enter in contact with the Hot Tasking Manager, and in this way they can they can interact. I mean, the server of Hot can interact with JOSM. Another point we noticed one time is that you have to activate also the expert mode, otherwise this connection won't work. And yes, I don't know clearly why, but these are the three steps you have to do. So log in with the OpenStreetMap account in this double screen icon, then activate the remote control here in the receiver icon, and then activate the expert mode, which is at the bottom left of the preferences panel. So once you did all these steps, you can go to the Tasking Manager, so to the project I shared with you, and you can click on one square to block one area for your mapping in such a way that other contributors are not taking your area. So you click on one task that you want, and then you select JOSM editor here, down below in the editor part of the Tasking Manager project. In this way, you are saying that you want to use JOSM. So if you have JOSM open already and you select the JOSM editor here, you can basically click on Map Selected Task, and the and JOSM will do a couple of things for you. As first thing, it is like basically it behaves like a GIS, so it has many layers. This is the layer for the it basically uploads the layers of the imagery that the manager of the project decided. So we decided to use Maxar, so automatically is displaying Maxar as an image. But in case you want to compare different images, you can go on imagery. In the top bar, and then you can select the imagery, the whichever imagery you want. So there is Esri, Bing, like also the OpenStreetMap rendering. So you have many options. And for example, if I want to activate Bing, I can click on it, and then you see I see now Bing. But if I click on the I option here to the left of the imagery, the layer will be deactivated, and so I can see Maxar again. And usually we map with Maxar because it's the most recent. And especially in a VA, we had also some internal satellite imagery, and we found out that this imagery is less than 1 year old, so it's very, very recent. Then there are other layers. There is this layer that is basically the boundary of the task, is not an important one. And then the data. What JOSM is doing is to download the data within the task area in such a way that I can manage the OpenStreetMap data. From time to time, I can download and manage the data. So I was quite fast, I guess. So let me know if you are okay with JOSM, or maybe I have to wait you. Like if you are downloading it, for example, or if you miss some step. So is everything okay?
For me, everything is clear, yes.
Okay, so let's see now the map. Let's see how to edit on JOSM. So I can see here and road. So basically, when mapping roads, the most important thing is to understand the role of the road in the road network. So you can see this road is basically not connecting any village, and is not even a main road. Not only because the width is not so big, but also because there are no villages around, and is going in an area which is pretty bare. There is nothing. So for this kind of road, we are using the track tag. And basically, when mapping in JOSM, to trace one node, just click A, the A button. And this way, you can click on the map and you will trace a node. If you go on clicking on the map, you will trace many nodes, creating a way, actually. And if you want to create a closed way, just click on the first node that you traced. In this way, you created a polygon. So if I want to create this road, I can click outside the task. This is important because in this way, the user that will download the area near to me will download also the way I'm tracing now, so it can continue the way. Otherwise, I will have like many pieces during validation to connect. So I can click many times on the map to trace the way. I can see that basically, okay, you see the way is basically is very difficult to understand like the exact path, because these ways are not like designed in a priori with urbanistic or urban planning. Basically, people are going around in Africa usually with like cars or scooters and so on in the middle of the desert. So they are basically creating these roads over the ground in depending on the direction they want to take. So basically, if there is a village here, for example, you see people are traveling to reach this village and they are creating roads. But if like in 6 months, maybe this village can be on another side of the, like on another part, they can move around. And so new roads will start to appear, reaching the new position of the village. So this is like a very dynamic environment, landscape, let's say. So let's go on with our road. We can go here, follow the path. To move the map, yes, I forgot to say this also with Olivia. Olivia, to move the map, you can just hold the right button to pan the map. To zoom in and zoom out, you can move the wheel. And with the left click of the mouse, you can trace the nodes. So let's go on with this tag until here. And with S, I can go in selection mode and I can end the editing of the road. Otherwise, maybe I can also click ESC. With ESC, I ending the editing of the road. So in this way, Okay, I traced a way without any tag. So you see, this is like only a line, an open line. And to add a tag, you can do it in two ways. You can select on the presets. You can go on the highways and then select ways and track. So in this way, you can see, like, this is similar to ID actually, because you can see that I'm mapping the track, and there are also all the suggested tags that you can put together. So you have, the one that is more important for us is the surface tag. You usually put unpaved. Otherwise, you can click on the arrow and you see many options. But unpaved is the one that we are putting. So you can click apply preset. And in this way, you can see on the right tab, you can see the tags. So there is a tag section with highway equal to track and surface equal to unpaved. So these are the two tags we put on this way. This is very nice because you can really understand, really the nature of the data. You can see all the tags, while in ID editor is not so clear. Many times, it's using like some definition. Some tags are also recalled in other ways, like. I don't know, in Italian, for example, in the Italian version, the track is like percorso agricolo. It is like, it's not, it would be easier, I guess, to use the tags as they are in English, but yes, I don't know. Okay, so we traced a track now. And you can see that there is a small settlement here. So if we want to map that one, we can trace, for example, a polygon to state that this is a residential area. To do this, you can click S in order to deselect every feature that you were selecting. So click S and you can click on the imagery. And then you click A, to enter the draw mode, and we can trace the residential area. So in this case, this one. And to add the other way to add the tags is to click here on add, and you can specify the land use residential tag. I heard a microphone, and maybe someone has a question.
So with the residential areas, you don't map the individual buildings, but just the area around it, basically.
Yes. Maybe I can go on OpenCMap just to show how it is rendered on OpenCMap. So if you go in a... Okay, let's say maybe we can go here. Okay, so basically, if we map the residential area, we are basically putting this gray polygon, which is basically a land use, and you are saying that people are living there. We are not interested in buildings, in the single buildings, because topographic maps, like a 50K map, is like this. Let me share like this one. So in basically, you cannot even see the buildings, and sometimes you cannot even see the residential areas because they are very little. Obviously, we are not using the rendering of OpenCMap. We are editing the data and rendering it in another way. But you can see, for example, here, if we zoom in, we didn't trace here the buildings, I guess. Yes, you can see these patches, and these patches are the residential areas. So, buildings for our purposes won't be rendered at all for the topographic maps, obviously not for the city maps. Yes, now we are editing for the topographic maps, and we are basically more interested in roads and waterways, residential areas, so this one, and places. So I will show now how to map the places, because we traced the land use equal to residential. And here we can see there are one, two, three, four, five, six huts. I guess it's a very small settlement, so we can put the place node. So to put a node, you can basically click twice on the same point in order to create the node. And then we add the place information. So we can, usually I'm writing it manually. So the tag in this case is place equal to isolated dwelling, because it's a very small settlement, and most of the times isolated dwellings don't even require a residential area. I mean, it's not necessary for isolated dwellings to put the residential area. It is mandatory instead with hamlets and all the settlements that are bigger than an isolated dwelling. At least this is like the way they are mapped the most in Africa, I mean, by African communities. So this is like our first village. We mapped this village. We can go on with the ways, maybe. So here there is a way that is going to the village, but anyway, I mean, these ways are not connecting many villages. Okay, I can see here another one, but they are very sparse. So I will go on mapping tracks in this case. So this track is going here, reaching the village. I will say up to here. Okay, and then there is one way is going back here, so I can trace it and connect it with the other way I was already mapping. An important thing of a road network is that they have to be connected every time, so basically, when mapping, we have to be careful to connect all the ways to the overall network in order to let, I mean, the routing algorithm to work fine and not to get fuzzy. So we can add the tag highway equal to track, and then surface equal to unpaved. Also, JOSM is automatically completing the fields. Here there is another track going above, so I will let's see how to manage the geometric objects. So with ways we can do many things. One thing is to we have this way, and let's say maybe we want to split it in two ways, for example, one going here. Then at this node, we want to create two ways and another one going here. So what I can do is to select the way. So click S to enter the selection mode, click the way, and then select the node by clicking the shift and then clicking also the node. In this way, I'm selecting an highway and a node. And then you can click P. And with P, I created, you see, two highways. One is here, is this one, and the other one is this one. So let's say now I would like to continue this track. I can select the track, select also the ending node of the track, and then I can click A to enter the draw mode. And in this way, I'm continuing to map the road. I mean, the object is the same. And this is I'm simply adding nodes to the collection, so the way is growing and is continuing. This is like some things that you can do with JOSM. They are can be useful many times when tracing ways in particular. Okay, so our tracker is finished, was going there, so it's nice. Here we have like a farmland, as you can see, there are many many farms. So I would say there is a way to go here, because this is, like you see, a very flat area, and I guess there are like, this is like sort of grass, but you see the traces everywhere, so basically they can travel easily in this area. So I will trace another track here. Well, you can do also some fast tricks, like you can with shift you can select the tags from the tags section. You can click Ctrl C and then you select back the way which is untagged. You click on the tags and membership section and you click Ctrl V in order to pass the tags, and this way you can easily pass the tags without digitize them every time. So here there is a track going to these farmlands, going through this crab here. Boom, boom, boom. Okay. I click the untagged way, I click the section and membership, the tags and membership section, and I click Ctrl B. In this way, I'm passing the track tag. So I can see another way here, but it's not basically going anywhere. So it is not very meaningful to add it, because you see there are many ways going all around. And most of the times it's important just to trace the ones that are used the most and that have a particular meaning without over-extracting. So I saw here, boom, a building. So if you just wondering how to map a building, you can both click create the vertices, close the polygon, then you can click Q in order to orthogonalize it. And if you want to move it, like for example, you want to rotate it off one angle, you can click Ctrl Shift. You can hold the Ctrl Shift and you can rotate the polygon. So this is like to adjust the shape. And then I put the tag building equal to yes. And this is a building. There is also a plugin you can download on JOSM for buildings. This is the building plugin. So to download a plugin, you go to preferences. You click on the plugin icon, which is this puzzle piece. And then you don't have any plugin, you have to download them. And then you search for the building tools plugin. You check this tick and then you download it. Basically, okay, you have to restart JOSM and so on. But once you downloaded it, you can trace a building simply like that. You click B, click one vertex, you click another vertex, and then you can trace the parallel, the perpendicular line to this line. And you created a building, and also the building will have already the building equal to yes tag. And for example, if I want to trace parallel buildings, I can select one building, click B, and I can trace buildings just holding one, clicking once and holding the and dragging the mouse, and this will be a parallel building. I can trace many of them really, really fast. I mean, this is like a win-win situation with respect to ID in tracing buildings, for sure. Okay, this is a building. There is no point this building is there. I think it's like a sort of farm or some sort of collector of something. So it is not an inhabited place, for sure. So we can leave it there as it is. Or maybe if you want to be like, you can put like, I don't know if it is, yes, building equal to farm, just to put it, but yes, we don't know. So let's put the building equal to yes, and that's it. So we mapped many, many tracks. Well, not so many, they are few, but I can see also a waterway. You see here, this vegetation and this way is basically a waterway, can be both a canal or a stream. I guess it's more a stream because it is very natural, and usually canals are like man-made, so they are easy to recognize. And also I guess this is like some sort of intermittent stream, because I cannot see it in this imagery. Can be also underground. So what I can do to map streams and waterways, I can check other imageries. So I upload other images.